We want you to know that you are our honored guest. Hope you will stick around for just a couple of minutes after services so we can introduce ourselves and get to know you just a little bit better. I know Roger has said a couple of things about it before, but I just wanted to make mention. At the bottom of the bulletin, we have all of our social media accounts listed. We have our Facebook, our website, our Twitter account, YouTube, all that stuff. This past week or so, we got a message through, I believe it was Facebook, of someone who is able to watch our services as we live stream them because she has to sit with her mother who is shut-in. She's unable to go to services on Sunday morning, and she was very appreciative of the fact that we are streaming the services and that she can participate and be a part of it in that way. So I just wanted y'all to know that, even though we may not see a lot of these people, you may not know about them, but we are reaching people, not just with the broadcast of the service, but hopefully with the gospel message. And for every one that we know of, maybe there's 10 or 20 that we don't know of that are out there watching. So it's good that we can be connected in that way. We've been talking about for the last couple of weeks our Extreme Makeover Spiritual Edition. We're going to continue that this morning and for the next two Sundays as well, go to the end of the month, and then we'll wrap that up. Last week, you'll recall, we talked about, actually 2 weeks ago, we talked about the first thing that we need in our Extreme Spiritual Makeover is a broken heart. A heart that is broken over the sin in our lives, a heart that is broken that God can repair and rebuild for us the way that He wants to. And then last week we talked about how we need to have calloused knees. Knees that are calloused from spending a life in prayer. And of course we're talking spiritually here, not necessarily physically. But we need to be people of prayer. We talked last week about improving our prayer lives and how we need to go to God in prayer. So those are the first two things we've looked at in our Extreme Spiritual Makeover. This morning we'll look at the next one, which is that God wants us to have crossed eyes. Anybody ever remember growing up and you crossed your eyes in front of your mother and she said, if you keep doing that, they're going to what? Stick. They're going to stay like that, right? Anybody ever have that happen? Okay, all right. I think that was just a mom thing, all right? Maybe you've seen babies that have been born and their eye muscle control is not really what it needs to be at that point. Their eyes are kind of crossed. You know, you've seen probably funny baby pictures of babies with their eyes crossed. I mean, maybe you have some of your own. Real cross-eyed people can't hide it. It's very noticeable if your eyes are crossed. Even if you have glasses or something to help correct that, it's very noticeable because it's not the way that eyes are designed to be. They're supposed to be, you know, out this way. They move together. They're not supposed to be crossed, and so it makes somebody very noticeable if they have crossed eyes. Well, the same is true for what God is calling us to do as Christians. When we develop crossed eyes, we'll be labeled as different too. And anyone who looks at us, anyone who talks to us, will be able to see that difference in our lives. And of course, I'm not talking about literal crossed eyes. What I'm talking about is having eyes that are focused on the cross. Eyes that are crossed in that way. You see, God calls us as Christians to gaze intently at the cross of Christ and to see everything through that filter, through the filter of the work that Jesus accomplished for us on that cross. And so being spiritually cross-eyed means that we will see the world differently. We'll look at the world in a different way than everyone else does. And you know, having literal crossed eyes, physical crossed eyes, makes everything seem out of focus. You know, if you've ever crossed your eyes and you're trying to look at something way out there, it looks out of focus and blurry. That's because when you cross your eyes, you're actually focusing in very closely. When we are spiritually cross-eyed, then we will have clear vision the way that God wants us to have it. Any of y'all remember these pictures? They were very popular, very fad thing back in the early 90s. The magic eye pictures, if I know what I'm talking about. They used to be kiosks in the mall that were set up, and they would have all these different kind of pictures in frames, and there's a hidden picture in there, and the only way to see that hidden picture is to kind of have your eyes out of focus, to have them crossed. A lot of people say, oh yeah, I see it. You know, they were just bluffing. I can actually see pictures. There's another one right here. I don't know if you'll be able to see it from there. And some of y'all probably think, man, you're pulling our legs. I promise you I'm not, okay? There is a 3D picture right there. And for those of you that can't see it, or even if you can, what's hidden in that picture is what's commonly called the and I would take the book and I put it right up to my nose like this, and I would slowly pull it out while not focusing on the picture but kind of looking through, and eventually it would come in focus and I would be able to see it. Again, you may not be able to see it from where you're sitting right there, but that's the only way you can see these pictures, is to kind of unfocus your eyes, to look through that picture and see what's actually there. You see, so many people are looking at life and they just can't seem to see the whole picture. Things aren't quite clear, but if we look at life with spiritually crossed eyes, eyes that are focused on freedom and salvation, that are bound up in the work of Christ on the cross, and the picture suddenly becomes clear. We're able to see meaning and purpose where there was nothing before. Like that 3D computer-generated picture, once you can finally see it, once you can get your eye to that point where they can focus on that picture, you'll always be able to see it. You'll never be able to unsee it. And so this morning I want to look at four very quick truths about the cross that help us to focus our eyes spiritually and become cross-eyed. Number one, looking at the cross of Christ forces us to make a decision. Ever since the resurrection some 2,000 years ago, people have had to decide what to do with Jesus when they hear about it. And there are really only two choices if you stop and think about it. When the gospel is presented, when the story of the cross is told, there's no such thing as indecision. Either you believe the story and you accept it at face value for the truth that it is, or you don't believe it. Those are the two choices that we have. Again, there's no such thing as indecision. You either believe or you don't believe. In 1 John chapter 5, verses 10 through 12, John writes there, "Whoever believes in the Son of God has the testimony in himself. Whoever does not believe God has made him a liar, because he has not believed in the testimony that God has borne concerning his Son. And this is the testimony, that God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life." You see, there is either belief and life, or there is unbelief and death. There's no middle ground. The cross forces a decision. And so when we look at that cross of Jesus in a figurative sense, when that story is presented to us, we have to choose. Are we going to believe and have life, or are we going to disbelieve and have death? It reminds me of the passage that's given in Deuteronomy chapter 30, verses 19 through 20, where Moses is about to die, and he is passing along the reins of leadership to Joshua, and he's given his final address to the children of Israel. He says, "I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessing and curse." You remember what that was? That he had presented to them basically what we know as the law of Moses. And in that law, there were things that the children of Israel needed to do in order to live, both physically, but more importantly, spiritually. And there were things that if they didn't do, there were some curses that were involved. And so he says, "I've said this before you," and he says, "Therefore, choose life, that you and your offspring may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying his voice, and holding fast to him, for he is your life and length of days, that you may dwell in the land that the Lord swore to your fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, to give them." That's what it boils down to. Life or death. Belief or unbelief. But the cross of Jesus forces us to make that decision. Number two, looking at the cross of Jesus, we will do it in the right way, creates unity. You see, the church is designed to be one body. There are many passages in the New Testament that talk about that, compare the body of Christ, the church to the body. One of those passages in Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 through 2, where Paul writes there, "So if there is any encouragement in Christ, any comfort from love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy, complete my joy," note, "by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord, and of one mind." You see, the church, Christ's body, is to be united. Now, this kind of oneness, this unity, is humanly impossible. We've talked about it before. Anytime you get more than one person together, things in this life that separate us, that differentiate us. Different languages, different nationalities, different upbringings. The early church wrestled with all of these things. There were Jews and there were Gentiles then a little bit later. There were slaves and there were free people. There were men and women. There were different languages being spoken. There were all these things that could have caused disunity, things that could separate people. However, Paul points out that the cross is the unifying force that is strong enough to overcome any differences that we have to build up as a single unified force with our focus on the cross. The cross that unites us. We need to focus on that rather on what makes us different. In Colossians chapter 3, verse 11, Paul writes there, here, meaning here in Christ, in the church, where we can have that unity, here there is not Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, free, but Christ is all and in all. You see, that's where we find our unity. That's where we find our common ground. Yes, we're going to have differences. We're going to have differences in the way that we're brought up, differences in the way that we view certain things, differences in even our accents and how we look. But in Christ, we can find that unity. In Christ, we find that common ground. We said, you know what? We are all working towards the same goal. We're all working towards the same thing. We can be unified in Jesus Christ. In fact, not just can be, we must be unified in Him. You see, the cross unites us to fellowship with one another. Now, in the Church of Christ, especially, we have come to use that term fellowship to mean the time we get together and eat, okay? That's not all that it means. We fellowship when we are eating together, but fellowship is just that coming together, that relationship that we build with one another, that bond that we have in Jesus Christ. Fellowship is what develops and nurtures unity in our lives, and yes, in our ministry as well. And it's important that we come together to fellowship, that we be together physically. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25 says, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another. And all the more as you see the day drawing near. God wants us to be together. He wants us to be unified. He wants us to build those relationships. And in a church that understands the importance of fellowship, I've said this before and I'm going to keep saying, everyone will feel known, will feel cared for, will feel loved, and encouraged. Relationships are essential to our faith and our walk in Christ and to the effectiveness of our ministry. So we need to understand and grasp the importance of being together, of fellowshipping with one another, of building this unity that only the cross of Christ can bring. Thirdly, looking at the cross also requires sacrifice. Roger talked about it in his comments at the communion this morning, how Jesus' sacrifice, when we say that, the words really don't convey what all that meant, what all Jesus went through for us. And when we look at the cross, we also are required to make a sacrifice and some sacrifices. In Matthew chapter 16, verses 24 and 25, Jesus said, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. Whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Notice that first phrase there. If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself. That idea of self-denial is that sacrifice that we're talking about. It's letting go of our will. It's letting go of, you know what, this is what I want to do. This is how I want to live my life. It's letting go of all that and saying, you know what, I'm going to live the way God wants me to. I'm going to follow the example that Jesus left me in order to live my life. And I'm going to sacrifice some of my wants and some of my desires. Yes, especially things that are sinful, things that the Bible speaks against, but even things that may be not sinful, but that aren't going to lead me closer to Christ and lead me to telling people about Him. You see, the very nature of the cross and what Jesus endured on it speaks of sacrifice. You can go back at the gospel accounts and you can read each one of those and the things that Jesus went through. How He was beaten. How He was put on trial, a mock trial, for something that He didn't even do, for charges that were laid up against Him. How He was nailed to that cross. How He was left there for 6 agonizing hours. because of you and me. Because he wanted to save us and keep us from having to go through that. He made that sacrifice. And so when we are willing to sacrifice, God promises blessings, but he also says that we can expect something else. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 12, Paul writes to Timothy, "Indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Know that not may be persecuted, not might be persecuted, will be persecuted." If we are going to give up our own lives, if we're going to follow after Jesus, we can expect persecution. It's going to happen. But you know what? It's through those hard times that we learn to trust him, and our faith is strengthened, and it takes root. And I like this phrase. I'm just going to read it the way it's written here. God's ultimate goal for our lives is not our comfort. You know, a lot of times people have that mindset that when they become Christians, that now all these blessings are going to happen, that everything's just going to be hunky-dory, all the problems in life are going to go away. And honestly, nothing could be further from the truth. Now, that's not to say that being a Christian isn't a great thing. It is. Because we know that we have that ultimate reward of heaven. But Paul here says, if we're going to be Christians, we're going to experience some discomfort, if you will. So God's ultimate goal for our lives is not our comfort. It's our character development. It's moving us towards looking like Christ. When we look at the cross, we see that sacrifices need to be made to live the life God calls us. So we need to keep that in mind, that looking at the cross in the right way is going to require some sacrifice. Then fourthly and finally, looking at the cross calls for celebration. We talked about the suffering that Jesus went through on that cross, and it was a horrible thing. But think about what he accomplished by doing that. What was lost has been found. The debt that could not be paid by us was paid by another. An eternity that held uncertainty is now full of hope and the promise of being in the presence of our God. A people who are far away have been brought near. A God who is inaccessible can now be known. And this is cause for celebration. We gathered around the table a few moments ago and we took that memorial feast, and it is a memorial. It's to remind us what Jesus did on that cross, but in another way, it is a celebration. It's a celebration of what he did for us. And it's a way that we can show our thanks and our gratitude and say, you know what? I'm happy that that happened. Not that he had to suffer, but because of what it means for me now. In celebrating, we fulfill our final purpose in that we were created to worship. You see, we're created to bring glory to God in the form of our praises. And our praises should flow from a deep sense of gratitude and thanksgiving for the life God has given to us through the cross. I want us to look at Psalm 100. It's a very short psalm, only 5 or 6 verses right here. I want us to look at it very quickly and notice the attitude that David has in this psalm. And I've got it up here, you don't have to turn to it. But in Psalm 100 he writes, "Make a joyful noise to the Lord all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations." This is a psalm of celebration. This is a psalm that every single one of us in here this morning could say and hopefully mean it, because we are celebrating the same thing. We are celebrating the fact that we are forgiven of our sins, that we have been saved. We don't have to look to that eternity and eternal punishment, but we can look to eternity spending it in heaven with Jesus Christ. And our worship, as this really is not just confined to this building or to just this one day a week, although this is important and we know that we need to be here, but this attitude of celebration, this desire to bring glory to God for our worship, is to be in our entire life. When we leave this building, when we go into our homes, when we go into our workplaces, we need to be happy and joyful that we are Christians. Romans chapter 20, verse 1, Paul writes here, "I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. We know that in the Old Testament times, they had to make sacrifices, you know, on behalf of their sins. They had to take those animals, the sheep and the goats, and they had to sacrifice those things multiple times. Here in the New Testament, Jesus has made the blood sacrifice once for all. And our lives, the way that we live it, the way that we commit ourselves to live for Him, is a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is our spiritual worship. Our greatest act of worship, our only right response to the truth that the cross calls for, is a life that is yielded to God. And we can celebrate that fact. And looking at the cross that way does call for celebration. The cross stands alone in history. No other symbol stands for as much, means as much, or accomplishes as much. And as Christians, this cross is to be in our thoughts and in our minds. We're to fix our eyes on it and on the one who gave himself up on it. When we do, we can't help but see that the work done on this cross needs to transform us. It demands a decision, and knowing that we must share with others the truth. It creates unity. When we recognize the cross as our common ground, we need to work hard to make sure that in our lives and in our ministry, healthy fellowship is taking place. Relationships are being built. Friendships are formed and deepened. And anyone who walks through the doors of this building is loved and accepted. And it does require sacrifice. Sacrificing our own desires and impulses for those things that God calls us to, and wanting to grow and sacrificing our own needs for the needs of others in service. Finally, it calls for that celebration. True worship flows from a grateful heart. See, it's only when we view our life in our church through crossed eyes and see the sacrifice that was made on that cross and the blood that was shed for us that we find meaning and we find the purposes that God created us to fulfill. And so this morning as we look at having an extreme spiritual makeover, I encourage you this morning to have crossed eyes. Eyes that are focused on the cross of Jesus, thinking about the things that we have talked about this morning, and letting that lead your life. Because in that way, can we truly be focused on what is right and what is good. This morning, if you don't have crossed eyes, if you're not looking at the cross of Jesus, I would encourage you to make that right this morning. To become a Christian if you're not one already, to repent of your sins, to confess the name of Christ before men, to be buried with him in the act of baptism, having your sins washed away, rising up out of that watery grave to walk and do a faithful life with him, with your eyes focused on the cross, and looking at the world through there. If you're here this morning, you've done that in the past, maybe you've wandered away. Maybe you haven't been looking at the cross the way that you need to. Maybe you haven't realized what it means to really be a Christian, to live that sacrificial life, to live a life of worshipful service to him. You can make that right this morning. Coming forward by asking for prayers. If you just need prayers for strength and for encouragement to live the kind of life you need to, whatever your need would be, we invite you to come and respond to him and stand.